It may or may not happen. It's not like I get updates. It's just I haven't heard anything for a long time. For us, losing Anton Yelchin the way we did was a real blow. And I think it slightly took the wind out of our sails in terms of our enthusiasm to do another one, just because we're now missing one of our family, you know, and it would be, he would be conspicuous by his absence, you know. We're all still in contact, you know, we were emailing with each other the other day, just saying, checking in, how are we and stuff. But it's not like any of us have been banging on the door of Paramount saying, hey, when are we doing this? You know, if they say we'd like to do another movie, I'm sure we'll all jump at the chance. I miss those guys, you know, and I love making those films, but I just don't know.
Finally, here we are, my very last retrospective video on the Kelvin Timeline Star Trek series. Throughout this entire series of video, we've literally talked about everything to do with the Kelvin films, from every last one of the three movies, all the way to every single multimedia piece associated with the Kelvin timeline, from the comics to the novels to, yeah, even that video game.
Are you all right, Captain?
I'm definitely better now, thanks.
It's honestly been a rather crazy journey. And while that seems like an insane amount of things to cover, the very fact that I was able to cover literally every single piece of this corner of the Star Trek universe, when compared with the sheer width and breadth of the entirety of the rest of the Star Trek franchise, is honestly rather surprising. Because in many ways, the Kelvin films have been one of the most pivotal entries into the Star Trek universe. So for our final video, I want to take a look at where the Kelvin timeline is right now, where it might be going, if anywhere, and what impact that it's had on the entirety of Star Trek, and what it has meant to me personally. And so, for possibly the last time, let's hit it.
All you Trekkies and TV addicts, don't mean to diss, don't mean to bring static. All you Klingons in the fucking house, grab your backstreet friend and get loud.
Despite hoping for a big breakout hit with Star Trek Beyond, and while it opened to critical acclaim during the Star Trek's 50th anniversary year, the 2016 film ultimately was a financial disappointment for Paramount, earning only $343.5 million, a huge disappointment after Into Darkness's $467.4 million box office. It's always weird talking about financial disappointments being in the millions of dollar range when literally I would kill for like even a smallest of percentages of that, but you know, capitalism is fun! But coupling that financial failure with the tragic death of Chekhov actor Anton Yelchin souring the entire cast's desire to come back to make another film, it seemed like Star Trek was once again dead. Or like a certain Vulcan first officer, or I guess a certain captain at this point, it's never safe to bet that Star Trek will be dead for long. Basically injecting super blood into this franchise, CBS, which had split from Paramount and still held the TV rights to Star Trek, formally announced in January 2017 that former Star Trek Deep Space Nine and Voyager writer Brian Fuller, who had later gone on to incredible critical success as a showrunner with shows like Dead Like Me, Pushing Daisies, and Hannibal, was coming back to helm a brand new Star Trek TV series, alongside Star Trek II and VI writer and director Nicholas Meyer. Yet as production began to move forward on what would become Star Trek Discovery, Fuller eventually had to leave the project to focus on his other show, American Gods, handing the reins over to Gretchen J. Berg, Aaron Harberts, Akiva Goldsman, and Alex Kurtzman. Despite some rocky behind-the-scenes issues with production and budget, Star Trek Discovery launched in September 2017 on CBS's brand new streaming platform, All Access, and became its premium series, and the only show worth watching on it, unless, you know, you're a big fan of the Good Wife spin-off The Good Fight, which, you know, who wasn't? I actually don't even know what it's about. I assume boxing? But despite what some YouTube channels might tell you, Star Trek Discovery helped lead CBS All Access to exceed the company's sign-up expectations, and alongside Star Trek Picard and Lower Decks, to this day has almost single-handedly kept All Access financially worthwhile, as competitors like HBO Max, Disney Plus, and Peacock have begun to sprung up. Though, for how long that'll succeed, we'll see. But at around the same time that Star Trek Discovery was coming about, Paramount, by contrast, was beginning to flounder. Outside of the successful Mission Impossible films, with Star Trek Beyond barely a financial positive alongside most of their other franchises like Transformers showing diminishing returns, Paramount seemed to be in a much more dire place than CBS. But looking over at CBS's success with the Star Trek franchise and the continued growing relevance of geek culture in the mainstream, Paramount seemed incredibly frustrated at the inability of their Trek movies to continue to gain traction. So, in an effort to try and get the next step in the Star Trek franchise right, Paramount began to cast a wider net. In 2017, in an attempt to capitalize on his Marvel Thor fame, Paramount announced they intended to do a fourth Kelvin Timeline movie with Chris Hemsworth returning as Kirk's father in a time travel plot. And I mean, as long as he appears in a movie shirtless, I'm in for whatever movie Hemsworth appears in, so... Yeah. It was even announced that S.J. Clarkson would become the first woman to direct a Star Trek movie helming this version of the franchise, which was honestly exciting and, you know, kind of sad that it had taken so long for a film franchise known for diversity in front of the camera to try and match it better behind it too. Yet despite this forward momentum, in 2008 the film stalled out with the Chris's Pine and Hemsworth dropping out, and Clarkson leaving for the Game of Thrones prequel series that's still in development, which was a worthwhile endeavor that everyone loved. While it was suggested that Pine and Hemsworth left over contract disputes, Hemsworth suggested differently, stating in 2009, quote, "I don't feel like we landed on a reason to revisit that yet. I don't want to be underwhelmed by what I was going to bring to the table." But as that movie was falling apart, at the same time, a rather insane development seemed to be brewing, with famed director Quentin Tarantino, known for his love of the original series and old Hollywood pop culture, stated that he had interest in doing a Star Trek film and even had a script, leading many Trekkies to say, "What? What the heck would a f***ing Tarantino Trek film even look like?" Tarantino himself even hyped up the film during his Once Upon a Time in Hollywood press tour. Though to be honest, one of my favorite quotes of his from this time is him trying to explain what even the Kelvin timeline even is. I still don't quite understand how, and JJ can explain it to me, and my editor has tried to explain it to me and I still don't get it, about something happened in the first movie that now kinda wiped the slate clean. I don't buy that. I don't like it. I don't appreciate it. Fuck that. I don't like that. I want the whole series to have happened. It just hasn't happened yet. And Benedict Cumberbatch, or whatever his name is not Khan. Khan is Khan. And I told JJ, "I don't understand this, I don't like it." And he said, "Ignore it, nobody likes it. I don't understand it, do whatever you want. If you want to do it the exact way it happened in the original series, it can." God, it honestly just makes me laugh imagining a phone call with J.J. Abrams just trying to explain alternate timelines to Tarantino. That must have been a surreal thing to experience, let alone listen to. But in any case, McCoy actor Carl Urban said the film idea was bananas, presumably in a positive sense, with reports saying that the script focused on a gangster tale in the line of the TOS episode A Piece of the Action, which in my mind would probably be the only way Tarantino Trek could even be conceivable.
"It's being taken over by the Federation, but we don't want to come in here and use our muscle, you know what I mean?"
But I'll be honest, I want to see this movie just out of sheer curiosity. I mean, it probably would end up like Zack Snyder's Batman v Superman, which was a total complete misunderstanding of the franchise, but one so wholly and completely fascinating it was hard to look away. Kind of like slowing down to watch a car wreck. But unfortunately for my own morbid curiosity, it appears Tarantino has backed down from his interest in doing a Star Trek. At least we get the Snyder Cut. But third and finally, Paramount in 2019 managed to grab one of my favorite screenwriters of all time, Fargo and Legion writer Noah Hawley, to pen a script for Star Trek. And it was reported that this film would not be set in the Kelvin timeline, but become more of a Logan-esque spin-off of the franchise. Yet in early August 2020, Paramount announced that they had tabled Hawley's script, as its reported focus on a viral pandemic seemed too close for comfort to, you know, a world in the midst of a global pandemic from COVID-19. But after that announcement, it was revealed that the Chris Hemsworth Kelvin timeline film was still miraculously a possibility. And Paramount's new film chief, Emma Watts, stated that it was her top priority to, quote, "figure out Trek." But with CBS and Viacom, which owns Paramount, recently re-merging and making the fractured Star Trek TV and film rights whole again, we're ultimately left wondering, at least at the time of this video's filming in late 2020, what's next for Star Trek on the big screen? Certainly, the future of Star Trek on television seems bright for at least the foreseeable future, but with the COVID-19 pandemic just beginning to completely change the Hollywood and theater industry, and Paramount unsure on how to proceed with Star Trek, we have zero idea what's next. And with each passing day, as the Kelvin Timeline's cast gets older and moves on to other projects, it seems less and less likely that whatever the next Star Trek movie will be, that it will feature Chris Pine, Zachary Quinto, Zoe Saldana, and the rest of the Kelvin USS Enterprise crew getting back to exploring the galaxy. Which is ultimately sad for a number of reasons. First and foremost, it's just a story level thing. Star Trek Beyond may have been the ending of a trilogy of films, but as I argued in my video on that film, Star Trek Beyond honestly felt more like a second movie in a trilogy than Into Darkness ever did. Indeed, Star Trek Beyond felt like it was the perfect bridge between the younger, brasher versions of the characters that we saw in Star Trek Into Darkness and Star Trek 2009, and the versions of the characters we knew from Star Trek the original series. So to leave those characters at the end of the third year of their five-year mission at the end of Beyond, still not fully developed into the legendary people we know they can and will be, leaves them in this state of arrested development, perpetually stuck with their arcs never completed. And for a franchise known for endless storytelling, it seems difficult to accept that these characters will never get a chance to end. I personally at least feel like they need at least one more film so we can just say goodbye to these characters. But why is that important? Well, in all honesty, I think the answer to why these characters need an ending in many ways speaks to the influence and importance of the Kelvin timeline as a whole. You see, the Kelvin timeline is arguably the most influential Star Trek iteration since Star Trek The Next Generation. Like TNG, the Kelvin films brought Trek to a whole new, generation, both behind the and in front of the camera. And certainly, Star Trek Discovery to Picard to Lower Decks all stem out of the influence of the Kelvin films, with people like the current Trek leading producer Alex Kurtzman joining the franchise with Star Trek 2009, becoming this era's Rick Berman, though thankfully he seems to be entirely less problematic and less stringent in what Trek has to be as a producer than Berman ever was. Yeah, I said it. I like Kurtzman as a showrunner. I'll see y'all in the comments. Also, if you're CBS, please send me the money you said you would pay me for saying that at your, you know, earliest convenience. But even outside of the people behind the camera, clearly the visual style and storytelling methods of Star Trek have all been influenced by Kelvin films going forward, from the lens flares to the moving camera to the more bombastic style of storytelling. Love it or hate it, the Kelvin films have influenced all of Trek today. And I'd recommend these two videos of mine, as well as Trekspertise's wonderful video, that have all discussed how the style of Star Trek has evolved in this modern era, for good or for ill. But I think the Kelvin film's most important influence has been on the Trek community in general. First, we should talk about the negative side of things. Every franchise today seems like it has a dividing line in the sand where either you love it or you hate it after this point. The Star Wars franchise has the Disney sequel trilogy, DC comic movies have the Snyder films, and Star Trek has the Kelvin timeline. And as a result, it seems that the Kelvin timeline, like those other contentious works and other franchises, have become more of symbols in a culture clash war in fandom that is itself a microcosm of the larger politicization of the United States and even Western culture, where either we are on the right side or the wrong side of the debate, and the other side is fully and completely our enemy. Public discourse has removed a lot of the nuance and discussion of the Kelvin films. There are those out there who use hyperbolic, over-the-top statements to continually frame Star Trek post the Kelvin timeline movies as vile distortions of what Trek should be, which sometimes, though to be fair, not always, are used to veil sexist and racist viewpoints. And honestly, I hesitate to talk about this too much because I've already done some videos on it, and I'm not here to focus on the negative, nor do I want the conversation to be defined by those voices. As I've always stated, love or hate Star Trek, be critical of new Star Trek, and you're welcome to disagree with my enjoyment of the newer forms of Star Trek, especially as I hope I've proven that my love of modern Trek is not wholly blind to its faults. I just ask that we all come to this discussion in good faith, with thoughtful opinion and respect for other points of views. Not hyperbolic hating on creators just trying to do their best to, you know, create. Nor hating on a show simply because it has more diversity in its cast than previous Trek shows, though still less diversity than what I think actual humanity of the future and a Trek-like utopia would even be. But bringing it back to our discussion on the Kelvin timeline, this whole issue that I'm talking about, one that is reflected in a lot of geek franchises right now, is symbolized in the Kelvin timeline and J.J. Abrams and Alex Kurtzman in particular. And as we know, both Abrams and Kurtzman have gone on to influence a lot of different things in geek culture. But moving beyond the negative, and much more importantly and positively, the Kelvin timeline, I think, did something much more beautiful for the Star Trek community. It made it bigger and more welcoming than ever before. As many of you know, I love Star Trek, but I also recognize that I came into it at a moment in my own life that was a very strange time for the franchise. I literally started watching right after Star Trek Nemesis came out and during Star Trek Enterprise's third season. Not exactly the best jumping on point for someone excited about the future of the franchise. but I was also welcomed into Star Trek by my father, someone who could at least guide me at my young age through the series and share with me his own love of Star Trek and passing on to me what would become a cherished adoration for the series, and more importantly to myself, a belief in the Trek philosophy of a future where humanity will pursue the best of ourselves and take delight in the differences of others. A belief that has helped guide my own choices as a human being, who works to fight for my own better nature and the belief in the best of others, even if they themselves don't always believe in it. Because Star Trek is often passed down from family member to family member, and I mean, I would take a solid bet that many of you out there watching this started watching Trek because of a parental figure in your life. But since Star Trek The Next Generation, Trek really wasn't all that welcoming to people who simply wanted to discover this franchise. Deep Space Nine and even Enterprise would firmly root themselves in the deep lore of the series, and while Voyager and The Next Generation movies were more accessible, they did see declining ratings and interest from the mainstream over the years, and didn't exactly scoop up a ton of new fans. That's part of the reason why Star Trek Enterprise ended where it did, because in its final years it catered to its fan base, which led to some of its best episodes, I will admit, but didn't exactly feel welcoming to anyone new. The Star Trek franchise failed to evolve, to keep boldly going. But the Kelvin timeline? It didn't do that. It felt like a new Trek for a new generation, to overuse that word. And while some feel the Kelvin films lost a little bit of what Trek was, I hope I've at least argued effectively in this retrospective series on the Kelvin timeline that in actuality, I believe that it brought the Trek ideals to a new epic. Now, certainly, it came with its own specific flaws that were different from the flaws of the era of Trek before it, but it also brought with it a brand new reflection of that beautiful ray of light that we all love about Trek. That love for diversity, difference, and a hope for the future. I mean, this is a weird example, but there's a reason that things like Kirk/Spock fanfiction came back with renewed vigor after Star Trek 2009, or Star Trek conventions began to see upticks in attendance after that movie. It showed that the message of Star Trek is still just as vital, if not more vital today, and the Kelvin movies gave more people the chance to discover it. The Kelvin films blew on the dying coals of the Star Trek fire just as they were about to go out, and reignited that flame. Even if the Kelvin films themselves didn't last long enough to see that fire become a roaring furnace again.
She still has a few tricks up her sleeve.
But love or hate them, I think we can all agree if we are going to give credit to the Kelvin films for anything, it's the fact that it kept this influential franchise alive for a new age group. And I think that was all worthwhile because we need this show. We need Star Trek. I need Star Trek. Because for me personally, each Kelvin film came about at a particularly interesting moment of my life. Star Trek 2009 came out right before I graduated high school, and as I spoke about before in another video, was the first Star Trek film I got to share with friends. Friends who had made fun of me or even bullied me before for my love of Star Trek. So Star Trek 2009 let me show a little more of myself to others, share this piece of my soul that meant so much to my worldview, and share it with people I cared about, and let them get a chance to see why it was so important. Into Darkness, which came a few years later, was released at the same time I was about to graduate from college. And the group of friends that I saw Into Darkness with were, at that time, and many of them still are, the closest friends I've ever had in my life. And Into Darkness also came out right at the same time that I came out as transgender to those friends. Once again, a Star Trek film came out just as I got a chance to share a little bit more of my true soul with the world. But Star Trek Beyond came out at a much harder time of my life. It came out right after I had started to transition and right after I had my gender confirmation surgery, you know, the big one downstairs, the one that I had been dreaming of getting my entire life. I had also been taking hormones and had been living publicly as a woman for about 2 years at that point. But Star Trek Beyond came out right when I had moved to Los Angeles and was one of the first movies that I saw when I moved here. It was also a time when I had lost a lot of my friend groups and was working a late night job swing shift that I absolutely hated with every fiber of my being. That job's hours mixed with my moving to a new city on top of me recovering from a major surgery made me feel more isolated and lonely than I had ever been, right at the moment where my body felt more me than it had ever been before. It was honestly an ironic moment. The moment where I felt more like myself was the moment when I had the fewest people to share my newfound confidence and belief in myself with. I felt truly alone. But funnily enough, a distant friend of mine, who I didn't really know all that well, but who worked at Viacom at the time, knew that I was a big Star Trek fan, and so she invited me to see Star Trek Beyond on the Paramount lot. Yeah, I actually got to see Star Trek Beyond at Paramount, which felt so cool and so amazing. But it was also wonderful too, because at that moment, I got to share Star Trek with someone, at a moment when I didn't really have many people to share it with. And I still cherish the memory of that day, not because I got to see a big Star Trek movie, but because it let me feel comfortable and at home during a time in my life when I didn't get to feel it all that much. Star Trek has always been more about sharing, about building a community, than it ever has been about a show itself. I love listening to podcasts about Star Trek, talking with others about Star Trek, making videos like this about Star Trek more than I do watching Star Trek itself, because Trek asks us to be our best selves and asks us to look for the best in others and actively brings us together around silly little sci-fi TV shows and movies. And so ultimately, I think the most beautiful and enduring legacy of the Kelvin Timeline movies is not that they only kept this community alive, but they helped it continue to thrive. And there are people today who are their own best selves because the Kelvin Timeline movies showed them a way to be those better selves. To paraphrase Captain Pike from Star Trek 2009, the Kelvin Timeline movies, as all good Star Trek does, dared us to be better. And I think we met the challenge.
Are you part of something bigger now, lassie? All right, don't you give up on that, because we'll sure as hell never give up on you. That is what being part of a crew is all about.
What do you choose not to feel?
I do not know. Right now, I am failing.
Put aside logic. Do what feels right.
And your father was captain of the starship for 12 minutes. He saved 800 lives. I dare you to do better.
And that's it for my retrospective series on the Kelvin Timeline movies. I'm honestly kind of sad that they're done. I honestly really love the Kelvin Timeline movies, and I hope that I've imparted even a little bit of that love to all of you through this retrospective, and maybe at least showed you a different ray of light or a different way to look at these movies, because they honestly just mean so much to me. But I want to hear about what you think about the Kelvin Timeline. Do they mean the same to you? Do they mean something else meaningful to you? Or do you absolutely hate them? I want to know all that down in the comments, because I just love the discussion. As I said, I love the community that we get to create around talking about these movies. This is honestly a passion project for me, so I really just am so glad that I got to give it to all of you, and I hope that you all enjoyed it. And, you know, the usual YouTube prayer. Don't forget to subscribe. Check out my podcast that I do, one called What the Frel, one called Star Trek Behind the Lines. You can also help me over on Patreon. It really helps me get to do more of these for you. I could not do these videos without my Patreon's help. So thank you to all of you. And thank you for watching this series. And, you know, as always, I hope that you, as always, saying that twice there, live long and prosper. Patrons, you are my patrons. You are so awesome. So here are your names: Catherine Lambeth, Eli Berg Moss, Ashley Allen, Bo Kikio, Miranda Janelle, Ashlyn Solstice, Greg Gillum, Stephen Kleinard, Camille T, Randy Thompson, Stefan Schuhart, Boyd Earl, and Mary Beth Earl, Wellington Marcus, Wayne Twitchell, Rick Osborne, Roar, Ish the Mad, Piston Twisted Garage, Dominic Noble, Buttoneer, John Steele, Michael Beam, Gavin Robinson, Carmen Olson, William Stewart, Amanda Ronya Idania, Hannah F., Nathan Olson, Andrew Jorgensen, BBD, Jason Knott, Maeve, saying it twice because I can, Andrew K., Bree Beecher, Jasmine, Nathan Steele, Skylar Gray, Lily, Tiffany Danger, Sean Piper, Wen Dizzlebizzle, Bush, Jane Packard, Geek Filter, Mari Neckard, Jacob Tovar, Polymenia, Celestial Dawn, Jean Mithun, Sarah Bystam, Din, Mark the Edge, Corey Honkinen, and Veil the Pale, Dunn, Lysa, W. Randy Eady, Andrew Lamoureux, Zone 1 Librarian, and finally, Michael Hardy. I am sorry for that, but seriously, thank you so much, patrons. You really mean the world to me, and you really are changing my life, even if I may have changed your life for the worst with my singing. Thank you so much for all of your support.